So welcome back. It's about time to kick off the best paper candidates session. We have three papers, as I said yesterday morning, selected as best paper candidates. The first is presented by Mario. The title of his talk is TCP at 100 gigabits per second, tuning limitations, congestion control. So please join me in welcoming Mario on stage.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. Hello all together. My name is Mario Hock. I'm from Karlsruhe Institute of Technology here in Germany. And I'm here to present you our work about TCP at 100 gigabit per second, tuning limitations and congestion control. This is a joint work with my colleagues Maxim Veit, Felix Neumeister, Roland Bless, and Martina Zitterbart. The main goal of our research was to investigate high-speed data transfers on off-the-shelf hardware. With off-the-shelf, we mean servers that you find in regular data centers with Ethernet, networking, and TCP IP stack. What's specifically out of scope of our research are high-performance compute clusters with InfiniBand networking, as you find in supercomputers. The main research questions are, where are the limits? What are the bottlenecks? And what's the influence on and by the congestion control? In order to answer these questions, a lot of tuning was necessary, which is also part of this talk today. So where are the limits? In order to answer this question, we set up a minimalistic testbed consisting of a single server as sender, a single server as receiver, and a 100 gigabit per second capable switch in the middle, and direct connections here. So in this setup, no congestion in the network can happen. And as you can see here in the plot that shows throughput over time, 100 gigabit per second can be achieved, but not with a single flow. The main reason for this is that a single flow is handled by a single CPU core, and we are just CPU limited here at about 42 gigabit per second on our hardware. But with three flows, we have three cores in use and can achieve 100 gigabit per second. This is not out-of-the-box behavior, though. Extensive tuning was necessary to get there, and we detect packet loss within the end system, which is quite unusual for TCP. Our total testbed consists of four servers, all equipped with Intel Xeon dual socket CPUs. This means we have 2x8 cores plus hyper-threading. Two of our servers are equipped with 2.4 gigahertz CPUs, the other two with 2.6 gigahertz CPU. We have 128 gigabyte of RAM. Our network interface cards are Mellanox Connect X5 and Mellanox Connect X4. We have both the dual port version and the single port version in use. The operating system is Ubuntu Server with the Linux kernel 4.15. The switch is a Dell EMC that has six ports that are 100 gigabit per second capable and a number of lower speed ports. Quite special about this switch is its large packet buffer, where we can have 100 milliseconds of queuing delay even at 100 gigabit per second. Where are the bottlenecks? In order to answer this question, we set up a flexible testbed in form of a virtual dump belt topology. Just as a reminder, a regular dump belt topology consists of a number of senders, a sender side switch, a dedicated bottleneck link, a receiver side switch, and the number of receivers. In our setup, we only have a single switch, but divided by VLANs. Our setup is shown up here. As you can see, we still have the dedicated bottleneck link, but directly plugged in from one switch port to the other and two separate VLANs. The main advantage of this setup is that we can easily reconfigure if a server is plugged in on the sender side or the receiver side without any manual rewiring. Also, we only had to use a single switch here. And we found out that an overloaded receiver is way more critical than an overloaded sender. And we tracked down the packet losses to the receiver side. In this plot, you see four different scenarios, and they show average throughput in our experiments and the variation. We had 20 reruns, and this is the variation among the reruns. Also, you can see the distribution of the retransmission events. Since the packet losses we saw were often burst losses, we always had a window of 100 milliseconds and counted all retransmissions that happened in this window as a single loss or retransmission event. With a single sender and a single receiver, as I just said, 100 gigabit per second can be achieved, but here, not in every rerun. I will discuss this later in more detail. Increasing the number of senders doesn't help us at all here. We still, with three senders and a single receiver, we have about the same performance. However, with increasing the number of receivers with a single sender and three receivers, we have a stable full throughput and a very low amount of retransmission events. With two senders and two receivers, some in-between behavior happens. But how is packet loss within the receiver even possible? With TCP, we usually have a feature called flow control, and its task is just to save the receiver from overload, actually. But TCP flow control works in the receive buffer. This means data is only sent from the sender if there's already space allocated in the receive buffer to store it. But the packet losses we saw happen at lower layers, at the so-called RX ring or receive ring. This is a shared data structure where the network interface card, the NIC, and the operating system can both access. If a packet comes in, data is stored in the main memory, and a pointer to it is stored in this ring. And in the interrupt handler, operating system gets the data out of there and writes it into the TCP receive buffer. So this ring can overflow at 100 gigabit per second when the receiver is under a lot of compute stress, even before the data is written into the receive buffer. Therefore, we can drop here even if there's plenty of space left here. In this case, the TCP flow control doesn't help us at all. On the sender side, there's a similar ring, the TX ring. Here, such drops do not happen because if this ring fills up, data just waits in the upper layer and is re-enqueued later. If in the intermediate system, the router or switch, the buffer overflows, then we have a classical congestion situation. And in the above experiments, this was excluded from happening. A lot of tuning was necessary to achieve 100 gigabit per second. All the numbers can be found here. I will not go much into detail about this. But we can sum it up in a typical tuning part and an advanced tuning part. First of all, we have to increase the limits for the flow control because the defaults are just too low for these high speeds. Also, there's a feature called offloading, TCP segment offloading, generic segment offloading, generic receive offloading. This is enabled by default, and it is very important. We just kept it on. Here, the hardware and the driver can take some stress from the TCP stack and reduce computational load. Same is true for jumbo frames. We also use jumbo frames. On the sending side, we changed the queuing discipline to FQ. This gives us a nice pacing functionality. This means data is sent out more evenly, so we have less spikes at the receiver. Also, the default is FQ coddle, and this one can drop packets at the sender. We don't want this to happen. But to really achieve 100 gigabit per second, advanced tuning is necessary. We increased the size of the RX ring to its maximum. This already reduced the number of packet loss quite significantly, but not to zero. Also, NUMA-aware core pinning is necessary. I will discuss this in the next slide. And in the same context, manual interrupt placement is necessary. After that, I will discuss how the TCP variant or the congestion control can also be a tuning parameter. Our systems are dual socket systems. This means we have not only a single chip with CPU cores on it, but two of them interconnected over the so-called quick path interconnect, short QPI. This is an Intel technology, but other vendors have similar technology. Each of these sockets, in our case, has 8 CPU cores plus hyper-threading. Special about such an architecture is that we often have non-uniform memory access, short NUMA. This means that the main memory is divided into two parts, and the one part can only be accessed by the one socket. The other part can only be accessed by the other socket. If, for example, a core of socket 2 wants to access memory that belongs to socket 1, this data has to travel the QPI link. And this link can be a bottleneck at 100 gigabit per second. And the same is also true for the network interface card that are attached over PCI Express, also to one of the sockets. And if a core here on socket 1 wants to handle the data, data also has to travel the QPI link. Dual socket systems are quite common on off-the-shelf hardware and regular data centers. However, there are also hardware with single socket or even up to 4 or 8 sockets are possible. Still, we think that our results are an interesting and valuable input if you don't have not only two sockets, but another number of sockets. Placing the applications and the interrupt on the core on either the one socket or the other socket is a very important tuning parameter. We call this NUMA tuning. Here in case one, this is the best case. We placed everything on this socket that is close to the NIC, to the network interface card. And this is also the setup I showed you the experiments above. Here, the results you all have already seen. We have a quite high throughput, but noticeable variance among reruns. And we have a noticeable number of retransmission events. In the worst case, case two, we put the interrupt handlers on the remote socket. And in this case, data has to travel this QPI link before the interrupt handler can take it out of the RX ring and writes it into the TCP receive buffer. And this is just where we see lots of drops here in the RX ring, where the TCP flow control will not help us. And we have very low throughput compared to the best case. Also, in this setup, data has to travel this QPI link twice, first to the interrupt handler and then back to the application. Case three is just the other way around. And it's very interesting in this context because here, first, the interrupt handler can take the data out of the RX ring, writes it into the TCP receive buffer, and then this low QPI link is there to the application. This is just where flow control works fine. We have a reduced load. The flow control reduces the sending rate, but we have almost no packet losses here. For completion, case four, where we put everything on the wrong circuit, again, we have lots of packet losses, but at least a little bit higher throughput than in the worst case. I mentioned several times now that we had quite a variance among reruns. In order to get rid of this variance, careful placements of interrupts and application within the socket is necessary. So far, we had distribution one. Here, we had for each TCP flow a single, a dedicated receive application, and each of these applications pinned to one specific CPU core. The interrupt handlers are just distributed evenly over all the cores. But since we only have three flows here, only three of these interrupt handlers are actually active. And if by chance, or let's say by bad luck, we have an overlap that one of the active interrupts are just on the same core than the application, then the throughput goes down. To prove this hypothesis, we use distribution two, where we made sure that such an overlap cannot happen. And now we have stable full throughput over all our reruns. Just as a cross-check, we use distribution three, where we made sure that every time such an overlap happens, and here the performance goes down drastically. Distribution three is also interesting because some tuning guides advise to put the interrupt handler on the same core for cache locality. But at our experiments at 100 gigabit per second, the locality on the same socket can be helpful, but not on the same core. As an interim conclusion, we can say that transfers at 100 gigabits per second are possible even between a single sender and receiver pair. However, extensive tuning is necessary for this, including NUMA considerations, interrupt placement, application, core panning, and so on. Still, packet loss in the receiving end system happen. By this tuning, this can be significantly reduced, but we assume that in practice, it will be hard to avoid to get completely rid of this packet loss. Therefore, the impact of this loss and the congestion control is the next question to answer. But why are we talking about congestion control at all? I just said we achieved 100 gigabit per second. Well, all these experiments have been conducted in a local area network with an RTT below 1 millisecond. If you use the same setting, the same tuning in a wide area network, then the throughput goes down dramatically. So what causes the bad performance in wide area networks? And why are local area networks not affected the same way? The default congestion control in Linux, but also all the other operating systems, including Windows by now, is cubic TCP. It is a loss-based congestion control. This means a packet loss is seen as a signal for congestion. The underlying assumption here is that packets are only lost during congestion within the router or switch. But having these packet losses in the end system confuses the congestion control. Here in this graph, you can see the congestion windows over time In this experiment, we had 4 flows in use. And you can see that all the congestion windows are reduced several times throughout the experiment. But during this whole time, there never was a single congestion event. In congestion event, you could see here on the RTT graph, because we have a buffer capacity of about 100 milliseconds. The RTT will increase by 100 milliseconds in a congestion event. So these reductions of the congestion window cause underutilization in wide area networks. In local area networks, we achieved 100 gigabit per second, but still, the congestion control is very much affected by these packet losses. Here we only show one congestion control window of our 4 flows and also the RTT. Again, you can see that there's never a congestion situation. We always have a low RTT, not increased queuing delay. And we can see that the congestion window is reduced quite often. But in the local area network, we have a small round trip time and therefore a small bandwidth delay product, BDP. And here, a small congestion window is just sufficient to fill the pipe. But as a comparison, this is how the congestion window should look like in this case without these receiver-based drops. Here, the distinct shape of cubic TCP is clearly visible. The increased delay I talked about is there. We have packet drops here at about 100 milliseconds queuing delay. The congestion window goes down. Of course, this is not ideal behavior, but it is a well-known issue of cubic TCP that it fills up all available buffer. Still, this is the expected behavior of cubic TCP, and the other one is not. In the LAN setup, this doesn't reduce the throughput, at least at the given loss rates, but the higher the RTT gets, the lower the throughput. So how to deal with packet losses? There's the well-known science DMC approach, they target high-volume data transfers, for example, transfer a large data set from one university to another, and they advise to build special zones at the edge of the network in order to eliminate all the middle boxes that could also drop packets independent of congestion. This can be firewalls or under-buffered switches or something like this. And this already helps a lot, but they do not target packet loss in the end system, and this is what we saw here. Another approach is our loss-resistant congestion controls. Google, for example, is working for some time now on BBR, and here packet loss is not treated as congestion signal. And in fact, no distinct congestion signal is at all is there in BBR. They just measure the throughput and adjust the sending rate accordingly, and they have some probing phases to probe for bandwidth and delay. But there are also delay-based congestion controls, like our own mechanism, TCP LoLa. Here, the queuing delay is the main signal for congestion and not packet losses. This graph here on the left-hand side, I already showed you. It shows the behavior of cubic TCP in the wide area network with large underutilization. The other two graphs show the same setting and the same tuning, but with a different congestion control, BBR and a modified version of TCP LoLa. This experiment shows us that 100 gigabit per second can also be achieved with TCP in wide area networks if you use a different congestion control. However, with BBR, there are a number of known issues that we already published in an earlier paper in 2017. But there, we only had 1 gigabit per second links and 10 gigabit per second links. And now we confirmed these results at 100 gigabit per second. For example, in this graph, you can see the elevated queuing delay, which is not supposed to happen with BBR, but it's clearly there. And in other settings, this would result in large amount of packet losses. TCP LoLa, on the other hand, we had to modify because by default, we just had packet loss still as congestion signal and reacted on it in a similar way than cubic TCP does, because we started with, in a wired network, at high-speed network, we won't have any packet losses there because we don't have any radio links or something like that. But now, this research shows that even in a wired setup, we have to take care about this as well. So the behavior of regular LoLa, as expected, looks pretty much similar to cubic TCP because we just react in a similar way. But since we have packet loss, we have queuing delay as our main congestion signal, We can, in a proof of concept experiment, we can ignore packet loss as congestion signal. This means, of course, we still send a retransmission, but we do not reduce the congestion window in this case. And this still gives us the expected behavior of TCP LoLa, quite stable, high, almost full throughput, and a low and bounded queuing delay of about 5 milliseconds. This is a tuning parameter, and it's set to 5. But what we learned from BBR is that just ignoring packet loss as a congestion signal can be quite dangerous, because in some cases, packet loss are a signal of congestion. The team at Google is already working on BBR version 2, where they again use packet loss as an input to the congestion control, but not as directly as a single packet loss always means congestion, we have to react. They try to be a little bit smarter about this, and this is also the way to go with TCP LoLa. This proof of concept experiment shows being smarter about packet losses is the right way to go, but this way has to be still to be gone. To sum up my talk, I want to stress out that network bandwidth grows way faster than single-core CPU performance. This means more and more extensive tuning is necessary the faster the network gets, and with each new generation, there can be completely new bottlenecks. Still, 100 gigabit per second can be achieved, but now we have this packet loss in the end system, we have to take care about NUMA considerations, interrupt tuning, core pinning, and so on. Novel congestion controls that are robust to non-congestion related packet loss can help with this packet loss in the end system, but as I just pointed out, a reliable congestion detection is still very necessary, especially at these high speeds, and therefore further research is required. Thank you very much for your attention. Now I'm open to your questions.
Hello, I was wondering whether your experiments used Ethernet flow control and whether if you had that enabled, it would mitigate the receive buffer loss.
We switched off Ethernet flow controls because we wanted to have an internet-like setup. Yes, we used jumbo frames, that's true. But otherwise, we wanted to be not like a data center setup, but more like an internet setup.
So would they have mitigated the receive buffer losses if it had been enabled?
Actually, I'm not 100% sure, but I think the Ethernet flow control will stop when the data is put in the RX ring. And I think it does not expand to the operating system, taking it out, take it into the receive buffer. But I'm not completely sure. This is a nice experiment to as a follow-up. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll hand over the mic. Meanwhile, the presenters of the second paper can enter the stage.
Please. Thank you. That's a very interesting thing because, let's say, supercomputing networks now meets mundane everyday computing to some extent. And 100 gigabit per second, more or less, saturates the whole system. That's one thing. So, and when you're pushing things to the edge, things getting fishy. That's always
right.
The way it is. And if you look at these kind of networks, for instance, when I look at supercomputer networks, where if there's something like ping pong latency in the vicinity of 2 microseconds or stuff like this, which means 2,000 instructions loss, more or less, for parallel computing. And I'm just wondering, when I'm talking about these speeds, is TCP the right thing? First of all, is something like Ethernet-ish stuff the right thing to do? And then a very technical question at the very end, did you use things like interrupt coalescing and stuff like this?
Yes, we used this, and this actually helps, but we used it in the way it is usable just on Linux. I think we had some experiments where the driver changed the settings, and we saw an increase in throughput, but this was already back at 10 gigabit per second, actually. But we did not extensive tuning there, like changing the variables of the interrupt coalescence. Also, this NAPI polling helps very much. Here, you have an interrupt, and then polling starts. For some cycles. This is all is enabled here. The first part of the question.
That was a very heretic one. I was asking whether TCP IP is the right thing, because nobody in the supercomputing area uses any internet protocol for some good reason, right? So I'm just wondering where's the layer here.
I think one of our main contributions is bringing together these very high speeds that are known from very close range protocols. but not from the internet. RTT is 20 milliseconds. Mm-hmm. And to look at the perspective of this congestion control perspective. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think we have to move forward from this. We actually are just we have a proposal for a project out there where we want to go beyond this reactive congestion control and want to be more proactive about this, that we already know what is the expected capacity in the network, for example. For example, it's also written in the paper, if you start a TCP flow, you have no idea if you have 1 kilobit per second, 100 gigabit per second, and this large range of scalability, you always use, especially latency, about to talk before, this, it costs latency just to probe, and then if you over hit the limit, then you create either packet loss, which again, does latency, or you have queuing delay, and again latency.
You replace knowledge by measurement, more or less. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
We have room for one remaining question. Yes, after that we will have to take offline questions.
Thank you. One short question about the emulation or the wide area network. Mm-hmm. How do you create the delay there?
Okay, I kept it out of this presentation, yeah. But it actually is an interesting question to ask, because we didn't use a real wide area network for these 20 milliseconds. We don't have those available at 100 gigabit per second. We used a delay emulator. We already had such a delay emulator in earlier work, but at 10 gigabit per second. And now we have the problem, it didn't scale up to 100 gigabit per second. We tried, but hit some limits. So therefore, what we already often do is we only delay the backward path, the acknowledgments. This works quite fine. But what we now had to do is to send the data packets over the 100 gigabit per second forward pass, and then have the aux over another pass at 10 gigabit per second, because the delay emulator wasn't faster than this. But with a little bit of triangular routing, this worked out.
Okay, so we have your delay on the backward pass, right. And this is it works for 10 gigabit per second.
This works at 10 gigabit per second. This also works with 10 gigabit per second cards, but the aux are so small, it's only 50 kilobit per second or something. But the same delay emulator also works with 10 gigabit per second on the forward pass, but not with 100.
I was wondering how you achieve delay emulation.
Yeah, this is a DPDK-based switch, that just a minimalistic thing that we wrote our own. It's already noted in the paper, and we used this already in early experiments.
Okay, thank you.
Good. So we thank the first speaker again.